Good morning, students. Now we finished with the general peritoneal cavity. Last lecture we saw what was lesser sac. Today's topic is peritoneal spaces. Peritoneal spaces. Now what is peritoneal space? Peritoneal space is a potential space which is present between the two layers of peritoneum. What are the two layers of the peritoneum? The parietal peritoneum and the visceral peritoneum. So potential space which exists between the visceral as well as the parietal peritoneum in the general abdominal cavity is what is called as peritoneal space. Now peritoneum is a very large area which is covering the whole of the abdominal cavity and the pelvic cavity. Alright, normally this is filled up with fluid, very little amount of fluid between the two layers, so that there is no friction and a nice layer of lubrication exists between the two. The problem arises when this fluid increases, like what we saw in pleura and pericardium. There is always a normal layer of fluid which is present. In case when that normal limit of fluid increases, then it starts to cause us the problem. The peritoneal spaces for our understanding has been divided into two parts. This division is taken place by the transverse colon. The transverse colon acts as a guide for us to divide the peritoneal space into two compartments. For example, if this hand of mine is the transverse colon, the part above the transverse colon is called as the supracolic compartment. My hand is the transverse colon, an imaginary line that we are drawing. This will divide the abdominal peritoneal cavity into two parts. The one which is lying above it and below the diaphragm. Remember, diaphragm or transverse colon ke beech ka jo part hoga, that will be termed as the supracolic compartment. The area which is below the transverse colon, the area which is below the transverse colon, will be called as the infracolic compartment. Now, the supracolic compartment is again divided into three parts. The supracolic compartment, that is above the transverse colon, is divided again into three parts. One is subhepatic, suprahepatic compartment, that is above the liver. Subhepatic, which is below the liver, and extraperitoneal compartment. Basically, the supracolic compartment was nothing but above the transverse colon and below the diaphragm. Now, between the diaphragm and the transverse colon, we've got a large organ on the right side, which is the liver. So, therefore, taking into consideration the liver, the supracolic compartment is again divided. Between the diaphragm and the liver, that will be called as the suprahepatic. Suprahepatic, liver se upar, suprahepatic, liver se niche, lekin transverse colon se upar. Okay, supracolic compartment, let us again revise. What is supracolic? Transverse colon or diaphragm, iske beech ka jo area hai, this is the supracolic compartment. We got a very large organ here which is called as the liver. Now because of this liver, this supracolic compartment again gets divided. So between the diaphragm and the upper surface of the liver, that compartment will be called as suprahepatic compartment. The one which is below the liver but above the transverse colon will be called as subhepatic compartment. The other one which is called is extraperitoneal. Extraperitoneal is usually that part which is not covered by the peritoneum. That is the extraperitoneal part. Okay? Hope you understood. Next we come down to what is the infracolic compartment. Now the infracolic compartment is that one which is present below the colon. The name suggests infracolic. The infracolic compartment is the one which basically forms the paracolic gutters. They are divided into two parts, right and left side. To understand this better,
let us go and raise the diagram for the same. Okay, now please concentrate on this diagram. We are just going to explain what are the potential spaces, that is what we spoke about was the supracholic and the infracholic compartments. Please visualize this diagram. This is from the anterior view when all the organs are in situ. Okay, they are, this is a schematic diagram to represent how the organs are there in situ in the abdomen. This is the ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, sigmoid, rectum, and arcanum. This is easy to understand. This is the liver, this is the stomach. Attached to the stomach, what we've made here is the spleen. Okay? Now, what was the division that we saw? It is divided by the transverse colon. So, this is the transverse colon. So, the part above this is called as the supracholic compartment. And the part which is below this is called as the infracholic compartment. Understood? Okay? This is the transverse colon which is dividing this as supracholic and this as the infracholic. Let us first talk about the infracholic compartment. The infracholic compartment is the one which is present below the transverse colon. Now, the infracholic compartment is again divided into two parts by the root of mesentery. Now, what is root of mesentery? Just we have seen in the first lecture of peritoneum, all the folds of peritoneum which are bilaminar, which hold the abdominal organs, are given some particular names. For example, for stomach, the name was given as omenta. For intestine, the name was given as mesentery. For colon, the name was given as transverse colon and sigmoid mesocolon. Do you remember the names? So, the part of peritoneum or the double layered peritoneum fold which is holding the long small intestine is what is called as the mesentery. So the mesentery is the one which divides the infracholic compartment into two parts. Now we have to see how this mesentery is attached. You know that the gut is around 8 meters in length and in the posterior abdominal wall, we don't have so much of space. So, this mesentery, which is around 6 to 8 inches in length, it exists between the fourth part of the duodenum, that is the duodeno-jejunal flexure, up to the ileocecal flexure. It is a oblong diagonal part of peritoneum, attached from the duodeno-jejunal flexure. See, this is the stomach. Okay, now let us see how this infracholic compartment gets divided. This is a schematic diagram, so we'll just try and understand. This is stomach. Everybody knows that the stomach continues down into the duodenum. Duodenum is a C-shaped structure. It has got four parts. 1, 2, 3, 4. The fourth part is the one which continues down into the jejunum. So where the duodenum and the jejunum meet, that is called as the duodeno-jejunal flexion. That is the starting point of the root of mesentery. Now what we are going to do, we are going to trace the root of mesentery. So just try and understand, if this is the continuation from the stomach of the duodenum, it is a C-shaped structure which comes like this. C-shaped structure which is coming out like this, duodenum is coming like this. From here, this cut section that we have drawn, this is the duodeno-jejunal flexure. This is the fourth part of the duodenum. This was the first part, the second part, the third part, and this is the fourth part. So from the fourth part of the duodenum, ahead from here, the jejunum will start. So this is called as the duodeno-jejunal flexure. This is the starting point of the root of the mesentery. I told you that the root of mesentery is diagonal like this. This root of mesentery now will extend up till the ileocecal wall, ileocecal junction. So, we are going to trace this root of mesentery up till here, this point. So, this is the root of mesentery. Did you understand?
what we are trying to do? We have traced that 6 to 8 inches of root of mesentery, which carries the long 8 meters of small intestine gut along with it. It is a long band which exists from the duodeno-jejunal flexure up to the ileocecal junction. This is where the ileum meets the cecum. This is large intestine. This is the cecal part of the ascending colon. This part, the lower end, is called as the cecum. So therefore, the gut will enter at this cut section, and this is called as the ileocecal junction. So can you see that the root of mesentery is such a big part, and how it is formed? This duodeno-jejunal flexure is placed at the level of L2 vertebra. Ileocecal junction of the root of mesentery is present at the right sacroiliac joint. The right sacroiliac joint. This part is right sacroiliac joint, and the duodeno-jejunal flexure. What is this called as? It is the duodeno-jejunal flexure. Junction. Did you understand the tracing of the root of mesentery? How is it formed? Again, stomach continuing into C-shaped duodenum. This is schematic diagram, so the proportions can be a bit different, but it is just for you to understand how the duodeno-jejunal flexure is being formed. Okay? So, first part, second part, third part, and the fourth part. The fourth part, which continues with the jejunum, that junction is called as the duodeno-jejunal flexure. It is present at the level of L2 vertebrae. From here, a diagonal band which goes up to the right sacroiliac joint. Right sacroiliac joint. It is called as the ileocecal flexure or the ileocecal junction. So this is the root of mesentery. Now, because of the root of mesentery, can you see this square infracoelic compartment getting divided into an upper triangular and a lower triangular space? Can you appreciate this? The ascending, the transverse colon, and the root of mesentery. Can you see this part here? Can you appreciate this part here? This is the superior recess of the infracoelic compartment. Superior recess of infra. The infracoelic compartment will have a superior recess, okay, because of presence of the root of mesentery. And this will again be divided into another triangle. The apex of the superior recess is directed downwards. The apex of the superior recess is directed downwards. This is the apex. Whereas the apex of the inferior recess is directed upwards. This is the apex. If you look at the diagram, you will understand that this is somewhat a closed chamber. यहाँ से बाहर निकलने के लिए कहीं जगह नहीं है, क्योंकि upper end के ऊपर duodeno-jejunal flexure ने close कर रखा है. लेकिन ये वाला जो part है, ये pelvic cavity में drain कर सकता है आराम से. You understand? ये जो है हमारा, ये pelvic cavity आ गया इसके नीचे. ये abdominal cavity था, ये pelvic cavity आ गया. So what we are going to understand here is ये जो upper triangular part है, recess जो है, infracoelic compartment का, ये bounded है. इसमें से निकलने की जगह नहीं है. तो अगर यहाँ abscess या कोई भी fluid collection होगा, तो वो contained रहेगा in a zone. Whereas अगर इस area में कोई abscess या infection या fluid collection होगा, वो drain कर सकेगा into the pelvic cavity. Okay? Now, what we spoke was of right and left parts of the infracoelic compartment. This is the right side,
right side is the one which is following the ascending colon. This is ascending colon. The left side is the one which is following the transverse, descending colon. This is the transverse colon. So, ये जो गड्ढा दिख रहा है ये between the lateral abdominal wall and the ascending colon, this is called as the right paracolic gutter. This is called as the right paracolic gutter. Similarly, this side between the abdominal wall, lateral abdominal wall and the descending colon, this is called as the left paracolic gutter. The right paracolic gutter between the right flank and the ascending colon. Ascending colon and abdominal wall. उसके बीच में right paracolic gutter. Lateral abdominal wall and descending colon. इसके बीच में left paracolic gutter. अब एक चीज इसमें जो है वो देखने की वो characteristic है वो याद रखो. This is freely open upside. ये diaphragm तक approach है यहाँ पे कहीं रुकावट नहीं है. और ये जो ऊपर का जो पार्ट है दैट इज द सुप्राकोलिक कंपार्टमेंट. सो राइट पैराकोलिक गटर इज इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद द सुप्राकोलिक कंपार्टमेंट ऑन द राइट साइड. ऑन द राइट साइड रिमेंबर ऑन द राइट साइड राइट पैराकोलिक गटर इज इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद द सुप्राकोलिक कंपार्टमेंट. यहाँ पे कहीं ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन नहीं दिख रहा ना, पूरा का पूरा थ्रू वे है. कम डाउन टू दिस साइड. I have drawn a green structure here. Can you appreciate this green structure? This is nothing but from the splenic flexure. This is the splenic flexure. This is the hepatic flexure. जब भी colon, transverse colon से जहाँ meet करता है, उसको कहते हैं hepatic flexure और splenic flexure. On the left side, there is a ligament which is given from the flexure to the diaphragm. This is called as phrenico-colic ligament. Phrenic मतलब diaphragm. Phrenico-colic ligament. Now because of this ligament, this left paracolic gutter, देखो इसके ऊपर जाने का रास्ता ब्लॉक हो रहा है. So here we don't have a through way because of the phrenico-colic. This green. Can you appreciate this? This is the diaphragm. It is going up to the diaphragm. This is phrenico-colic ligament. The phrenico-colic ligament also supports the spleen. Can you see? This is the spleen. The phrenico-colic ligament also supports the spleen, and because of this phrenicocolic ligament, this left paracolic gutter is not in direct continuation with the left supracolic compartment. Can you see the difference? Because of this, there is an obstruction to the path, whereas on the right side, there is no obstruction. So, the right supracolic compartment is in direct continuation with the right infracolic compartment through the right paracolic gutter. This is called as the right paracolic gutter. This is called as left paracolic gutter. In some books, they have again divided it into this is right lateral and this one which will be onto the medial side will be called as right medial paracolic gutter, which we have divided it as the recess. कई बुक्स के अंदर राइट पैराकोलिक के अलावा इसको भी नाम दिया है एंड दिस विल बी कॉल्ड एज राइट मीडियल पैराकोलिक गटर. नाउ व्हाट इज द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फीचर ऑफ दिस राइट मीडियल पैराकोलिक गटर? इट इज ऑब्स्ट्रक्टेड. वी सॉ दिस नो. राइट साइड में कोलोन आ गया, इधर रूट ऑफ मिसेंट्री आ गई और ऊपर ट्रांसवर्स कोलोन आ गया. इसको निकालने के लिए बस ये थोड़ी सी जगह है बस दैट्स इट अदरवाइज इट इज बाउंडेड द राइट मीडियन पैराकोलिक कटर डिड यू अंडरस्टैंड दिस हियर द लेफ्ट लैटरल पैराकोलिक कटर एंड हियर दिस विल बी द लेफ्ट मीडियन पैराकोलिक कटर बट दिस लेफ्ट मीडियन पैराकोलिक कटर वी ऑलरेडी सॉ इट इज इन कंटिन्यूएशन डाउनवर्ड्स विथ दी पेल्विक कैविटी ये ध्यान रखने की बात है दो चीजें विच यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड राइट साइड का पैराकोलिक गटर सुप्राकोलिक के साथ में कंटिन्यूएशन में है लेफ्ट वाला नहीं है बिकॉज ऑफ फ्रेनिकोकोलिक अब एक चीज इसको दी एक चीज इसको नहीं दी सिमिलरली एक चीज इसको नहीं देंगे और एक चीज इसको देंगे तो राइट मीडियल जो है वो बाउंडेड है वो नीचे नहीं जा सकता वो ऊपर भी नहीं जा सकता ये लिमिटेड है लेकिन लेफ्ट मीडियम दिस इज फ्री टू द पेल्विक कैविटी समझ में आ रहा है ये कैन यू जस्ट अंडरस्टैंड इस वाले को पूरा परमिशन था इस वाले को परमिशन नहीं था सिमिलरली अब अंदर वाले को राइट साइड को परमिशन नहीं है लेकिन लेफ्ट मीडियम को परमिशन है सो दिस इज इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद द पेल्विक कैविटी सो इन केस इफ देयर इज एनी इन्फेक्शन हियर इट कैन परकोलेट डाउन इनटू द पेल्विक कैविटी ओके आई होप यू अंडरस्टूड द राइट पैराकोलिक राइट लैटरल पैराकोलिक द राइट मीडियम पैराकोलिक द लेफ्ट मीडियम पैराकोलिक द लेफ्ट लैटरल पैराकोलिक सो देयर आर टोटल फोर गटर्स टू ऑन द राइट साइड टू ऑन द लेफ्ट साइड द राइट साइड कंटिन्यूस विद द सुप्राकोलिक द लेफ्ट डज नॉट कंटिन्यू द लेफ्ट मीडियम कंटिन्यूस द राइट मीडियम डज नॉट कंटिन्यू ओके विद द सेम थिंग वी विल जस्ट ट्रेस व्हाट आर द रिलेशंस ऑफ द रूट ऑफ द मेसेंट्री The relations of the root of the mesentery. It is often asked in exam what are the relations of the root of mesentery. So we'll just follow it with the next diagram. Okay. Now let us also revise here what are the relations of the root of mesentery. Abhi tak humne discuss kar liya infracolic compartment. How the infracolic compartment is divided by the root of mesentery. Okay. Root of mesentery ke jo relation hai, they are also often asked in exam. पहला पॉइंट हमने डिस्कस कर लिया था ड्यूओडेनोजेजुअल फ्लेक्चर व्हिच कम्स एट द लेवल ऑफ L2 सेकंड पॉइंट हमने रूट ऑफ मेसेंट्री का कर लिया था व्हिच इज द राइट सेक्रो इलियक जॉइंट व्हिच इज आल्सो कॉल्ड एज द इलियोसीकल जंक्शन इलियम और सीकम के बीच का जो जंक्शन है इलियोसीकल ऐसे डायगोनल सी ये 6x8 इंचेस की रूट ऑफ मेसेंट्री अब रूट ऑफ मेसेंट्री के पीछे क्या क्या रिलेशन है रूट ऑफ मेसेंट्री किन चीजों को क्रॉस करती है हम अब ये देखेंगे क्योंकि ये कई बार एग्जाम में पूछा जाता है तो फर्स्ट थिंग रूट ऑफ मेसेंट्री क्रॉसेस द एब्डोमिनल एओर्टा इट क्रॉसेस द एब्डोमिनल एओर्टा दीज आर स्कीमेटिक डायग्राम्स ओनली टू बी ड्रॉन फॉर योर एग्जाम नेक्स्ट IVC abdominal aorta IVC posterior to this what we have is psoas major muscle the right psoas major muscle the right psoas major muscle from abdominal aorta we have the right gonadal artery the right gonadal artery and from the right side we have ureter coming from the right kidney the right ureter which will go into the pelvic cavity Okay, so these are the posterior relations of root of mesentery. Please remember, this is often asked in exam. This is a schematic diagram that you can draw to represent the
posterior relations of root of mesentery. That is, what are the structures which the root of mesentery, when attaching from the duodeno-jejunal flexure to the ileocecal junction, what are the structures it crosses? Number one, abdominal aorta, IVC. I hope you can visualize. Right psoas major muscle. From the abdominal aorta, the right gonadal artery, and from the kidney, right ureter. Let us just write it down from left to right so that you understand. Number one, abdominal aorta. Number two, IVC. Number three, right psoas major muscle. Number four, right gonadal artery. Number five, right ureter. So from left to right, abdominal aorta, IVC, right psoas major, right gonadal artery, right ureter. These are the posterior relations of root of mesentery, often asked in exam. I hope you understood this. With this, we finish with what is called as the infracolic compartment. Okay, we have seen here that the infracolic compartment, which consists of the paracolic gutters, it continues down into the pelvic cavity below. Okay, the right lateral paracolic gutter, it is freely open to supracolic as well as pelvic cavity. On the left side, the left lateral paracolic gutter and the left medial paracolic gutters, both are continuous with the pelvic cavity. Only which one is not continuous? The right medial is not continuous with the pelvic cavity directly. Understood? So let us see now, how does the peritoneum reflect on the pelvic cavity? Please come down this side. The pelvic cavity, we have divided into a male pelvic cavity and a female pelvic cavity. The male pelvic cavity will contain the urinary bladder, the accessory organ, and the rectum. Okay? The female cut section will have the bladder, uterus, vagina, and the rectum. Understood? Let us trace the peritoneum, which is going to line the pelvic cavity. So, how is the peritoneum going to line the pelvic cavity? From the posterior abdominal wall on to the anterior surface of the rectum, slightly on to the posterior surface of the bladder, and then to the superior surface of the bladder, to the umbilicus on the anterior abdominal wall. This is the pelvic tracing, peritoneal tracing on the male pelvic cavity. You can see a pouch which is forming between the bladder and the rectum. This is called the rectovesical pouch. Rectovesical pouch. What is the name? Rectovesical pouch. Understood? This is in the males. The peritoneum will only dip down onto a small surface of the urinary bladder on the posterior surface. It doesn't go down. Remember this. only a small portion on the posterior surface of the urinary bladder, and then it will reflect onto the superior surface of the urinary bladder, forming a pouch which is called as rectovesical pouch. Understood? Now let us come down to the female side. What happens in the female side? Again, from the posterior abdominal wall onto the anterior surface of the rectum. Now remember, on the female side, it will dip down till the posterior fornix of the vagina. Till the posterior fornix of the vagina, on the posterior surface of the cervix, the uterus,
area, that is the perineum. It is around 5.5 centimeter
from the perineal area in a lady, because it is the most dependent part in the body. If there is a fluid collection or exudate which collects here, the peritoneal discharge can be removed by approaching the pouch of Douglas from the vagina and the posterior fornix. So you can insert a needle from the vagina through the posterior fornix of the vagina. This is the posterior fornix of the vagina. So from the posterior fornix of the vagina, you can approach through a needle into this rectouterine pouch or pouch of Douglas in a sitting position in a female, in case if there is accumulation of any fluid or any exudate which needs to be removed. This is easily accessible. It is easily accessible. कोई organ नहीं आ रहा है जिसको आपको injection या trocar डाल के आपको कोई सामान निकालना है. Easily accessible, only 5.5 centimeters from the perineum. You can approach it from the posterior fornix. You can go into the pouch of Douglas and remove the discharge. Therefore, this is the most important part of the peritoneum in a female pelvic cavity. Similarly, in a male, the vesicorectal, the recto vesical pouch will be the most dependent part. Okay?